something you want to hear from the voice of Cerritos College, WPMD on the Net, where people make a difference.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Falcon Spotlight. That's right, folks. This is America's best public affairs student radio show, and that was named by the Intercollegiate Broadcasting System this year. At this time, I would like my guest to please introduce herself.
Well, good morning. My name's Norma Rodriguez, and I am the Director of Student Program Services here at Cerritos College.
Perfect, perfect. So what I like to do when I have my guests is start off from the beginning. What was K-12 like for you? Were you involved in, like, a sport or music? What were you into back then?
Actually, K through 12 was an interesting journey for me. My parents immigrated here to the United States when I was very young. And so I was very, I would say I was very introverted, very shy in school. I did enjoy school. I loved school. It was fun. In terms of areas that I was really active in, I think I started getting more active in school as I got older, when I went into high school. So I loved dance, and I was on the modern dance team and took a little bit of ballet and tried a little bit of gymnastics, but that wasn't for me. Pretty much that was it. You know, I went to Fountain Valley High School, close to the beach, so spent a lot of my free time at the beach with my friends.
Perfect. And so after high school, did you know right away what was next? What college, what major you wanted?
Actually, no. College wasn't something that was what we talked about at home, you know, during family time. As I stated before, my parents were immigrants, and so they've always instilled hard work and really strong ethics and values to our family. But we didn't talk about college, and I think that, and I know now, based on my experience, that wasn't my parents' experience. For them, it was starting a new life, coming to a new place, and seeking opportunity for the family. So my parents have always been very hard workers. So no, college wasn't something that I thought about. My friends talked about it, and they talked about the schools they were going to go to, but it was seemed foreign to me, and it seemed like it wasn't for me. Therefore, I did not go to college after high school. I went to work.
Okay. And what jobs did you do?
So I've always liked fashion, and I started in retail. As I got older then, I transitioned into the banking industry and had a really wonderful job as a teller and worked myself up as a new account specialist and finally a supervisor in the branch.
And when did you know you wanted to go to college?
Well, interestingly, at that time, the banking industry was having problems, and so I worked for a very small savings and loan, and it no longer exists. And so we knew that there were problems, and so I was seeking opportunity. And a friend of mine had mentioned that there was a job opening in her office and that she worked at a college. Would I be interested in applying for that? And so I thought, why not? That sounds interesting, to work at a college. And I did apply, and I was very fortunate to get the job, but it was made very clear to me that this was a temporary assignment. Therefore, I would only have the assignment for 3 months. Well, that 3 months has become my lifelong career, and I've been here at Cerritos for over 30 years.
Wow, that's incredible. tell us about, like, did you go through different positions, or what have your duties been throughout this time?
Right, and so I started as a part-time hourly employee, and the person whose job I was filling in for decided not to come back. And so I had an opportunity to apply for that job, so I became a full-time classified employee. Shortly thereafter, and I had that job for many years. I did quite well in my job, and my supervisor reclassified my position, And then I had an opportunity to sub for another senior staffer who was on a medical leave. And so I gained more experience with working with grants and private funds. So I did start out in the fiscal office. During my classified position, I worked closely with ASCC, with all of the ASCC budgets, to include the bookstore, cosmetology, culinary, and in meeting the students, I really got really involved with student life, and it was fun. You know, I liked that part of it, so I became very active on campus, and I would attend all of the events and activities that were held here on campus. And so an opportunity came about where they were looking for a position in the financial aid office. And I thought, you know, this is perfect for me because now I'm going to be exposed to students, which is what I really felt that I really liked. I liked that contact with students, learning about their experiences and helping them. And so I did get that job. And when I did transition over to financial aid, I worked closely with counselors. We were in the same area as the counselors, and that's when I really started getting the desire that, you know, I need to go to college too, and it's not just for young people. So I did go to college. I started taking classes, and I started taking part-time classes. And so it took me many, many years to get my degree, but I got my degree at Cerritos College, and after that it was just I was hooked. I loved education, and I knew that that would give me the opportunity to speak, you know, to spend more time with my students. So I did get, I transferred to the Cal State Dominguez Hills and got my bachelor's in interdisciplinary studies with a minor in psychology. I was really liking psychology. I really enjoyed the courses. And so when I completed my bachelor's, it just seemed natural to go into psychology. So I applied for the master's in clinical psychology and graduated with also an MFT option, which gave me the opportunity to practice. And while all that was going on, I was also having the other opportunities came up. And so I was able to do some part-time counseling here at Cerritos College. After getting my degree, that's when the opportunity presented itself. But then I was trying to make a decision, where is it that I want to go? I love counseling, I love meeting with students, and so it just seemed right that that would be the area that I would go to. One of my mentors kept urging me to apply for management positions, and I was thinking, management, you know, I'm not sure. I know I'm good at it, but I really like that positive, you know, contact with the students. And so he said a position was coming up, and he really wanted me to apply for it. And so I thought, okay, you know, he's always been very supportive of my educational growth, and so I'll try it. And so I didn't feel I had anything to lose because I knew I was going to go into either educational counseling or clinical counseling. And I applied for it, and I got it. And so that brought me into management as the director of the CalWorks program, which I hold dearly in my heart. Our students are just amazing, and their stories are incredible. And if you don't know what CalWorks is, CalWorks is a program that is the social services. So our students are parents with children, and they're given the opportunity to go to college so that they can get off of the social assistance and be independent and self-sufficient. And it's just incredible to see their growth. Many of our students are non-traditional students, meaning they're older. They didn't come to college right out of high school. They have children. They're living in extreme poverty. And it's just amazing to see their growth as they get involved in education and it becomes a part of who they are. And we have many success stories, many.
Excellent. We'll be right back after this quick break.
James,
It's just that I usually take two breaks afterwards.
Would you like a bottle of water?
I have a gallon of water here.
Okay.
You know, I haven't met you.
I'm Casey Bukowski. It's great to meet you.
Norma Rodriguez.
No, nice to meet you, Norma. Thank you for coming in and giving us some of your time.
Thank you.
I always like getting people's stories.
I do want to talk about international, though, because that's something that I've been with for 3 years now, so I don't know how to bring that in.
I just have to read this thing real quick. We all need to go to the financial aid line, but hate waiting in lines there, right? Download the Queueless app and be free of waiting anywhere. You can wait anywhere on campus. With the Queueless app, you can get real-time updates on your status in line, and you'll be notified when it's your turn in line. It's so easy, you can even wait in line while you're in class. Download the Queueless app now and skip the wait in line. A public service message from WPMD on the net, where people make a difference.
This is the story of Daniel, who was born 2 months early. He weighed 1 pound, 7 ounces. His lungs weren't ready. His heart wasn't ready. His brain wasn't ready. At the hospital, the nurses said Daniel
was a fighter. I remember I was super nervous when I first did my first show, but after a while, you know, time goes by so fast.
Daniel's parents spent night after night at the hospital, watching his every breath, holding his tiny hands, and looking for signs that he was growing stronger. At home, his parents looked around Daniel's empty nursery, at the quiet toys, and the still rocker, and they hoped that one day they could sit in that rocking chair and tell this story to their very healthy son. Daniel's is just one of the more than 500,000 stories of babies born prematurely last year, but there's hope for a happy ending. The March of Dimes is funding the research and programs to stop premature birth. You can help bring more babies home healthy. Learn how at marchofdimes.com. Working together for stronger, healthier babies.
We'll mention it. And welcome back to America's Best Public Affairs Student Radio Show. That's right, folks. This is the best public affairs radio show in the country among all colleges and universities, thanks to the Intercollegiate Broadcasting System, which awarded this show a golden microphone. So this has been an interesting show so far. And, you know, I always ask my guests this question. Who have been some of your inspirations?
Well, I've had many inspirations, but truly I have to say that my parents, you know, they really inspired me to really work hard and to give back. And that's something I've done all my life in whatever area or capacity I was working in. So I would say my parents were my primary inspiration. And of course, I've been inspired by so many leaders that we've had, political leaders, political activists, that really, you know, make a difference in people's lives. I think those are the ones that I'm most inspired by. I love the Dalai Lama, of course. You know, just his, although I'm Catholic, and, you know, his religion is Buddhism, I really, really appreciate the basic tenets of the Buddhist religion. And so I have to say I'm really inspired by the Dalai Lama.
Great, great. So, you know, many of us at when we get through college, we always think that, well, most of us, we think midterms and finals are the most stressful times. How did you cope with finals and midterms? What were some of your strategies?
Well, I had some challenges because I had children, and so I had to balance family life and work, and so that was always the balance for me. But I know that we would do homework together, so while I was doing my homework, my children would be doing their homework. So that helped me do some of my work. But as I got older and I was in my graduate program, I did have a challenge, and it was an interesting one. I'm the one that, you know, spend so much time with my parents, and I used to spend weekends with them and call them every night, or they would call me. But in my graduate program, I couldn't do that. And so that in itself was a challenge. My parents couldn't understand why every time I called, I kept saying I'm working on a paper. They didn't quite grasp that. To them, they thought a paper, isn't that a one-piece paper that you write something about? And so I could hear the frustration and the sadness in them, and so I had invited them to spend the weekend, and I took them to my office, and I said, let me show you the paper that I'm working on. And on the floor, I had all of my lit reviews, journal articles, books, and on the computer, I had my 25-page paper that I showed them. And they were in shock because, you know, education wasn't a part of their life. They understood now when I said I'm working on a paper, they understood it. But to an extreme, it's like after that, they didn't call me that much because they were afraid to interrupt me. But it was an interesting story, at least to put it into perspective what that looks like to someone who's never gone to college.
And, you know, sometimes it can be stressful with most people sometimes have to balance work and school. How did you time manage everything?
Well, I tend to be a very hard worker, and so sleepless nights, I think, was one of the ways. Coffee helped a lot, and I used to come home and quickly, you know, go straight to my office and do my homework. So, yeah, it was hard work, late nights. Sleepless nights, and that's how I was able to balance it.
Another thing, sometimes some students, they'll just go to class and they'll go straight home, but what are the benefits of getting involved on campus as well?
I think the benefits are fantastic, and I encourage all students, please get involved. Especially here at Cerritos College, we're a very, very small community. We have longtime members of our community that are really involved in student success. And there are events every single day that you can attend, lectures by prominent faculty, performances. But most importantly, we have a very strong student government. We have so many clubs of interest, where you meet new friends that have the same interest as you do, and you expand your social networks, and these are your future partners when you graduate, and your lifelong friends. I think it changes, in my opinion, getting involved on campus changes your life so much because you gain other people's perspectives. We're a very diverse community, so many of our students are from different countries, and it's just learning what that experience is like. So I encourage all students, please get involved. It really does change your experience.
And one of the other questions I ask my guests is, what would you like your legacy to be?
Wow, that's a very deep question. And so I guess I would just want people to remember me as someone who really cared, someone who made a difference. Whether in an individual's life, in society. I think that's really important to me. I think based on all of my interest, I'm really grounded in social justice and equity. That's very important to me. And I guess I would like to be remembered as someone that made a difference.
Perfect. The other question I ask is, where do you see yourself after retirement?
Well, I've been thinking about that. Although I'm not close to retirement age, I do. My husband and I have talked about this. It's something that I'm just really passionate about. So I suspect it will happen because I'm very determined. I would love to retire in the islands, the Hawaiian Islands, and during my retirement, I would like to still be able to help others. Maybe. Whether working part-time at a community college or at a clinic, a free clinic, doing some good work on the side to help others. But I think spending my golden years on a beach with the sun.
You know, another thing that I think students, you know, when they're first-generation college students, sometimes they may be lost, especially the transition from high school to college, the fact that, a campus is bigger, and, people always recall their first day. What was your first day like in college?
That's a really good question, and like I said, I was a non-traditional student, so I actually went back to college as an older student with children as well, and so I felt intimidated because I thought, gee, I'm going to be the old grandma in the office or in the classroom. I really wasn't that old, but wasn't 18, so it was intimidating, and I remember even working here as a part-time employee. It was hard for me to go to college. I remember before my classes began, a very close friend of mine, I had shared with her that I was really scared and I didn't know what to expect and I didn't even know where my classes were, even though I worked on this campus. And so she's a dear friend, a lifelong friend. She actually took me around campus and with my class schedule, we looked for my classrooms that I would be going to so that I would at least be able to find it. First day of class, but yes, it was intimidating. I think I had a lot of noise in my head, but as I got more involved in college, I think the noise was a little bit less loud, and I started really enjoying my classes.
We have a very diverse campus. It's pretty cool when you get involved in clubs. For example, there's a club called the International Students Association, and the club, we've had, this is a club where students have the opportunity also to meet, international students and, form friendships and, help each other know where places are and stuff. But we also have an international office.
Yes.
So can you tell us about it?
I would be delighted to tell you about it because that's also the office that I oversee, the Office of International Student Services. And it's a beautiful program. Right now, we have about a little under 200 students, but these students are incredible. These, primarily, I think Cerritos College has students from Southeast Asia. So we have our largest contingency of international students are from Korea, from China. We have a host of different countries. So we'll have a few students from Europe. But for the most part, I would say Korea, China, Japanese students, and Vietnamese students are probably the most that we have. Some of our students start out in community ed in the intensive English program, but the majority of them are here on the credit side. And it's just wonderful to just learn from them, to see their hunger and their enthusiasm. And it's really important that we get those students connected with our domestic students because put yourself in their place. These are traditional students, so these are like 18-year-old young people right out of high school, leaving their home country, leaving their families, coming to a foreign land with what they think this, they have their own ideas of what America is like. And so there's quite a bit of cultural adjustment involved. And so the ISA is a way to help our students because the ISA has a good balance of international students and domestic students. And the domestic students really help our students through that transition, which is quite difficult.
Yeah, and I see, I think I met two of them right here from the the pamphlet here before. They were part of the club.
Yes. So it is a very active club. They do a lot of great things here. They really do. But you know what? It changes each year. Sometimes you've got that group that's really involved, and then they graduate, and then you get the new group of students. But they really do some exciting work together. Global Village is something that ISA is really proud of doing every year.
Yeah, for those that don't know, Global Village, every club that signs up, they'll have a booth that they will host, and each booth represents a different country. So it's been pretty cool. The other thing that I thought was pretty unique when I had the chance to go check out the club was they have various meetings, but at least once a month they would have what is called international tea time. And basically they would have someone from a student that was an international student would have like a poster board with like different facts and stuff about their country, and they'll have you in a PowerPoint, and then we'd be introduced to like a dish from their culture, and it was pretty cool.
Actually, it's funny, the first club meeting that I went to, it was one where they actually had a tea time, so it was beautiful. And it was the Philippines. And so the student gave a PowerPoint, talked about his country, talked about his experience when he was younger, and then provided us with traditional Filipino food. So you get to eat and enjoy and learn. And then the other part of the segment, they did dancing. So they actually made me dance. But it was fun. They're just a fun group of students. I encourage all of you to come if you have an opportunity to one of the meetings.
And tell us about this upcoming event.
Well, I'm really excited to tell the campus about International Education Week. This is something that's a collaborative between the Department of State and the Department of Education, and actually all colleges and universities, or I should say most colleges and universities, celebrate International Education Week. And it's a way to promote the beauty of international education, whether it's study abroad for our domestic students to study in other countries, or the international students coming into our institutions. And so we're really proud of it. This month, it's November 14th through the 18th. We have flyers and posters distributed throughout campus. We have a week-long series of lectures and performances. We're proud to say that we've got some of our prominent faculty who will be presenting some presentations. We have Carlos Arce, we have Dr. Obazuaye, we've got Dr. Anna Torres-Bowers, and we're also going to have a dance group, so that'll be fun, in the Student Center on Wednesday. And we also have Professor Walter Fernandez. And on the last day, we're going to get to hear from the Child Development Center that uses an Italian curriculum on how they conduct the Child Development Center. So we hope that you can attend. They're free, and we will have food and refreshments at all of these events. And you're going to come back with some really good information.
Great, great. Tell us about each of the individual day activities here.
Sure. So on Monday, we've got Professor Arce. He's a professor of Spanish. And his topic is going to be today's threat to world sites. So he's going to take us to the enchanted paradise of Titicaca Lake and Puno and Cusco and Machu Picchu, exploring these treasures of Bolivia and Peru, enhancing the brotherhood between these countries in order to conserve these magical sites. On Tuesday, we're going to have United Nations simulation. That sounds really exciting. Dr. Obazuaye is going to have his students from his club who are going to simulate a Syrian refugee crisis in Europe. And so they're going to conduct a simulation as if in the United Nations, attempting to resolve a crisis. And this is a real crisis that's going on right now. Very timely. On Tuesday, we've got Professor Anna Torres-Bowers, a professor of philosophy, and Anna's going to be talking about global ethics and the good life. And so she wants to address moral issues that we face in the 21st century, such as climate change, terrorism, poverty, HIV, AIDS, racial and ethnic violence, religious extremists, deforestation, and species lost and food insecurity at a worldwide level. So this really sounds like it's going to be thought-provoking and very insightful to hear what's happening. And then on Wednesday is the fun dynamic dance group at Maha and Company. And so there's going to be some Latin dance, and they also do cultural awareness through their dancing. And well, you might want to come out and join in the festivities. Thursday, we're going to have Walter Fernandez, a professor of history, and his topic is the frontiers. And so his presentation is going to be as in the concept of American Western frontier, but also mentioning phenomena common to the northern frontier of New Spain, including California, the Argentine Pampa frontier, the Canadian frontier, the Australian outback, and the Brazilian Sertão. So that should be an interesting presentation from Professor Fernandez. And if you've ever seen him, he is very engaging. and thought-provoking as well. And Friday, we will hear from the director of the Child Development Center, Debra Ward. She will have some of her staff and also some of the faculty that teach child development. And they're going to be talking about their experience when they traveled to Italy, where they participated in an international student study group with other educators from other countries. And through that, they also came back with the Reggio Emilia curriculum, which is what they currently use in the Child Development Center. And it's kind of like a similar to Montessori, but it's a very respectful manner that they teach the children to be very independent, to be creative, to be very inquisitive. And so this would be one that I would certainly think would be a good one to attend. So we hope that you're able to attend all or at least some of these. And again, we're going to have some refreshments and some snacks and some good conversation.
Yeah, and I mean, lots of these, some of these, they're also club advisors. They're very active on the campus. And, you know, that's another thing, too. You know, when students get involved on campus, it wasn't until I got involved that I realized, you know, faculty and staff, you know, they do a whole lot more than just, you know, whether it's a professor teaching. There's more to it, and there's more to it than even just office hours. You guys hold a lot of hats, and there's so many meetings you guys attend.
They're so passionate, our professors here on campus, and really engaging. And they do this as part of their, you know, the regular assignment because they feel passionate about it. So I certainly hope that you can make these events. And it is open to the campus community and to community members as well that are outside of Cerritos College. And to let our faculty know, flex credit is available for many of these events. So this is good. So hope to see a variety of folks and mostly our students come.
Yeah, it's definitely entertaining and very informative as well, different types of activities. These workshops are very informative. Definitely check it out.
Robert, I wanted to add something if I could. Student engagement is really important for international students, for all students. But for international students, we see that sometimes they tend to be the ones that go to class and then go home. And so we really put a lot of effort and planning to try to engage those students. And so one thing that I'm really proud of that we do twice a month, every semester, we've been doing this now for, it'll be a year at the end of this fall, it's our own tea time. And so tea time is held twice a month on a Tuesday from 11 to 12. We invite our international students, but we also want to invite our students, our domestic students, our faculty, come and meet an international student. The event is just open, and sometimes the conversations go in different directions. Sometimes the students do presentations, but the goal is to engage our students, to get them to meet new people, new friends, and to get involved on campus. So please look out for our tea times, and it's open to anyone on campus that would like to attend.
Definitely. And in addition to the CalWorks and the international students, what was the other offices you oversee?
Those are the two programs that I oversee currently, yes.
And for CalWorks, I believe there was another club that kind of relates to it. I believe it was called Spice Club?
Yes, actually, many of our CalWorks students are in the Spice Club. The Spice Club is sponsored through the CARE program on campus, and they have many commonalities, and so it's a really fun club for the student parents to get together. They do some really good work, too, from my understanding.
Yeah, we have various active clubs, and even the Child Development Club in the past, it also won the prestigious, you see, on top of students being recognized, clubs are also recognized as a whole, and it was not that long ago, Child Development won Club of the Year, so that was pretty interesting.
That's exciting.
But yeah, there's, that's another thing too. I mean, there's so many different activities and that occur sometimes some are exclusive to spring, some are exclusive to fall, but they're every year. What would have been some of your favorite moments?
Some of the events that I've attended here? Mm-hmm. Well, I always like to attend the homecoming events. Those are fun. And I've had the opportunity to be a judge, and that that takes it to a different level. From Mr. Cerritos to, you know, just judging the, I think when they have the chili cook-off. But I think that, gosh, I've had so many experiences attending some of the wonderful plays that we have on this campus. We have some incredible plays. I just missed a performance, I guess, the Women of Juarez, but I was reading the talent marks, and that seemed like that was an amazing production with many of our students, right, as the performers. So I would say that I just try to get involved and participate in all of these events because, you learn about our students, but you also learn about... you know, what's going on in outside of us, you know, what's going on in society. So I don't know that I can pinpoint one specific one that has been my all-time favorite, but there's been so many, so many.
And we'll be right back after this quick break.
I didn't know what to say. I didn't know if I heard your question there. Like a specific event that I love.
Or any moments... Franco, we can mention Franco.
You know, now I've made it a habit to invite Franco. What we do with International, they're mandated by the, International is mandated through the Department of Homeland Security. So all of the mandates, the requirements, the monitoring of the students is part of that. And so orientations, you know, information overload. We do a welcome.
The thought of my sons growing up without me inspired me to quit smoking.
Semester. We invite people from all over, community members, faculty, staff, anybody that wants to say hello.
Instead of smoking.
And, and in that welcoming, I invited Franco. My staff was saying, oh, it's going to make it funny, silly. But that's what we want. We have funny, silly.
I get up and take a walk.
It's the hit now. The students are all want selfies with Franco. He does the funniest things. He or she, I don't know. I don't know what Franco is. I think that's a he, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't say that the very first time I tried.
Yeah, so he comes and they just love him. They love him. I love him too because sometimes I go up to speak and people are still chattering because it's a very social event. And Franco will just like... You'll start banging on the table and telling
people
to be quiet.
That's fine. He's pretty hilarious.
He is.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Rob Flores, and this is Falcon Spotlight, America's best public affairs student radio show. And, you know, ladies and gentlemen, another highlight of the campus definitely has to be our mascot. Tell us about our mascot.
I love Franco. Franco is, he has a way of engaging students. His personality, it's dynamic, and he's, you almost think that he's like a real person, the way he acts and his mannerisms. We actually invite him to our new welcome reception that we host for international students. That's an event to get them to meet our administration, community members, and Franco has come to the last two, and I think he takes the cake. You know, he's the one the students love. They take selfies with him. He is just a little ham. Love, Franco.
I think the most hilarious moment also has been at the awards banquet, the dinner. As people are going to the food items, when they get to the chicken, he's like, no. Like if he's trying to say, don't eat my cousin. Don't eat him.
I know. You just start seeing him as a person almost, right? With his mannerisms.
He's very energetic and totally hilarious.
Yes.
And yeah, I mean, there's so many different events and stuff that occur on campus. You know, it's just amazing. You know, there's always all kinds of activities for students to be a part of.
One thing that we really are seeking is your voice as students, because we do have a lot of events and activities that happen. And sometimes these events and activities have to happen when faculty have their release time, so it's like at a certain time. But we try very hard. I've spoken with many colleagues on campus to have them at different times so that we can get all students to come. So we need your voice. Let us know when you really want these events, when these events work for you. Maybe evenings are better, or maybe afternoons, or Friday could be the best date because you have less classes. But we want to hear from you so that you can, we can have these events when you can attend.
And then another thing is, students may not realize it's actually pretty easy to start a club. You have to do it at the beginning of the semester. Have to get, I believe, 10 students on the list, 5 officers, and they just have to have above a 2.0, 2.25, I believe, for officers. And you write down which classroom, you have to know which classroom you're going to meet in, is it available, and then just find the advisor, and it could be any full-time faculty member, or you can have a full-timer and one part-timer so that they could be co-advisors as well. So it's definitely another cool thing is starting a club.
And I will add that if anyone is looking for an advisor, please give me a call. I'd be interested in helping start a new club.
Yeah, and that's another thing that amazed me too is, a long time ago, not that long ago, I had a journalism class, and we had the opportunity to make our own blog, whatever topic we wanted. And I decided, I think it'd be interesting to find out about the history of the organizations we've had on campus that students have been able to join. And when I walked into the activities office, there was these plaques, and these plaques listed the early clubs, because there was a time when clubs were established, their names would be added to this plaque in the year that they were established. And there's such a rich history because, some of the clubs would date back to like the late 50s and to like the 90s and stuff. And it was pretty amazing.
Back in the, I'd say in the 80s, we had sororities and we had fraternities. And that was different. And the Greek life was quite exciting.
Well, that would have been cool to check out. And universities, they totally have them also. So that's pretty cool. And here at Cerritos, on top of being part of a club, in order to further spread news quicker about activities that students can be a part of, there's a council that's composed of a representative from every single club. Inter-club council. So that's another great way to get involved, or if you haven't ever been to a meeting, that's one of those ones you catch up pretty quick on what's going on or upcoming as well. There's just so many different opportunities available to students here, or even just someone that's, thinking about joining the school and they just want to see what's going on. It's pretty cool.
And remember, students, you pay fees. You pay those student activities fees. So those fees are what is used by our student activities office to produce a lot of these events and activities for you. And they provide funding for the clubs as well. So, take advantage of it. You've put into it, and it's good to be able to, also receive something from it.
And another quick and informative one of the most vital days, I think, is probably Welcome Day and Welcome Night and Club Info Day, because everybody is all out there, and there's different informative booths that you can go ahead and get meeting times of when clubs meet, or even online. Our website is pretty cool, too. www.cerritos.edu, so definitely that's another way to, check out the whole website. There's various different, what do they look up for your department?
And so most departments, I would say all departments, have their own website as well that's connected through the college's main website. And so it's usually the www.cerritos.edu/ and the name of the department. So it would be /CalWorks if you want to hear about CalWorks, or /OISS for the Office of International Student Services. You can also find all of these areas on the ABC link on the main website. Just go to the ABC link and look for the department or the area that you're looking for, and click on there and you'll get a lot of good information.
And you know, when people go to like where the EOPS office is, there's like two different sides in the door. I think there's a, what is it, CARE or REACH or something like
EOPS
that?
EOPS and CARE and LINK are in that one area, yes.
And what's the difference between those programs?
And so there are many programs on campus that have categorical funds that provide support services to specialized groups. So, for example, CalWorks gets funding through the state and also through the social services to provide services to students in terms of counseling, assistance with supplies, and workshops. EOPS is also another categorical program that's funded through the state, and they provide a host of support services to students. Students can get grants, they can have work-study opportunities, they can get fee waivers when they're getting ready to transfer to the university. There's so much support through that program for EOPS-eligible students, and also CARE as well. CARE is funded through the state, and then they have the funding to do support services with the students. The club is one of those areas, but I believe they also get grants and assistance with books. So, so there's a lot of support available to students. Please get involved. Student services have so many programs that you really need to be part of. Everyone should fill out a financial aid application, even if you don't think you're going to be eligible. Fill it out. You may be eligible for a fee waiver, and a fee waiver is worth its weight in gold. It will pay for your classes. So please, I encourage everyone to apply for financial aid for EOPS and CalWorks, CARE, depending on what your where you would fit in. Also, we have the disabilities program, and there's a lot of support through that program. Beautiful faculty that work there to help students, accommodations for students in the classroom. So student health services, we've got, I hope I'm not leaving anybody else, career services, counseling. They're all part of student services. Campus police. Campus police does amazing work right now. They're doing a lot of outreach because they really want to get the word out about safety. And they have even, I believe, Coffee with a Cop, which is a new event that they're hosting. So please get involved with all of the student support services.
Yeah, and DSPS, it's a pretty interesting program. You know, if you have a disability, all you got to do is, you know, bring your paperwork and fill out an application. And there's services like if you need a note taker, or maybe you need your textbook put in audio format, that's another great resource to learn to succeed in your classes. And different accommodations, like maybe if you need to take your test within their test room. So there's different accommodations available for those you that need accommodations. But yeah, there's so many different things that are available for students, and that's another thing. You know, the application process for the programs like international students or CARE.
CARE and CalWorks, EOPS.
How does the application process work?
And so they all have different application processes. For CalWorks, many of our students are actually referred to us by the county offices. But we know that there's CalWorks students here on campus that aren't even aware that we have a CalWorks program. And so we really are working hard as a staff to come up with ways in which to get the word out. because we do have those support services. We have a computer lab, we have study rooms, and sometimes there's just 2, 3, 4 students. So this is a dedicated lab with a computer and a printer for CalWorks students. EOPS has the same for their students, EOPS and CARE. Disabled Students Program also has another lab, and theirs is high tech. They've got all the special software that you were talking about that will help someone that's visually impaired or someone that has needs assistance with audio. All of these are there for students. You just please come and use them, because I think it's kind of, although we think that we've gotten the word out, we're still not getting the students coming in, international students. We've got a computer lab, study rooms, come in and study. There's beautiful resources in the Student Success Center, but realistically, when you have over 20,000 students, you know, there's you've got to compete with someone for a computer, for a place to sit down and read. But all of these support services, they offer that to their students.
Yes, it's, you know, I know that sometimes there's bashful students that they'll be too shy to ask questions, but don't be afraid to ask questions, because there is so many different resources. Yeah, because there are those shy, quiet students. But definitely another thing that students may not be aware of is, you know, the process of how the school works. It's amazing, you know, shared governance, you know, that's another important part of the campus. Can you tell us about shared governance?
Sure, and so, yes, shared governance is very important to our campus. And in the shared governance committees, there is representation from every constituency group on campus. So there are managers that represent ACME, there are faculty that represents Faculty Senate, there are classified employees, and also students. We need the student voice in these shared governance committees. And how you get involved in that is you get involved in student government. Those are the students that are invited to attend these meetings. But also, many times, many of us, you know, we really want to hear from you. We want your voice, whether you're in student government or not, so we're looking for students for focus groups. So those are advertised on flyers. It's important to get involved in shared governance, because decisions are made in these committees that affect student life. So the student's voice is critical. We also have a student voice in our board meetings. There's a student representative that's there to be the voice of all students, to advocate for students for additional services. And our board members and our president, they want to provide what students need. They just need your voice. So please get involved. And I say get involved in student government, because that's where you can make changes that just, they don't just affect you, but they affect the whole student body. And, you know, that's something that's really important.
Yes, if anybody is interested in joining student government, there are 3 different branches you could choose from. There's the cabinet, which meets on Mondays at 2, or there's the court that meets Wednesdays at 11, or the senate that meets at 2 p.m. These are definitely, there are 3 different opportunities, basically, you could be a part of, and all you got to do is go into the activities office and ask to how to apply.
And don't be shy, because part of the being in student government, you get training. You get training on how to be a leader. And so I know that the students get a training on parliamentary procedure, and that's critical. And they get you know, supporting documentation to help them be effective during these meetings. So you don't have to be an expert to join student government. You just have to be interested in wanting to make a difference and make a change, and you will get the training that you need to make those effective decisions that affect all students.
Yeah, a lot of people, you know, they can go in with no experience. It's fine. They'll learn everything. And what's interesting is, you know, on top of parliamentary procedures, you know, there's even rules of, like, you know, the agenda has to be posted at a certain time, the Brown Act, Robert's Rules of Orders, and all those different types of procedures. You learn that all over there. So it's pretty cool. But I want to thank you for taking the time to be here on the Falcon Spotlight.
Well, thank you for inviting me. It's my pleasure.
And ladies and gentlemen, this concludes this week's episode. Tune in next week as my guest will be Dr. Xin Lu. And you'll get to hear about what was school like for her in Taiwan and her success story leading up to where she is today as one of our board members. Until next week, folks.